Okay, I just realized I was talking to myself for a good like minute and a half. So I will re-say what I just said. We should be live. And I'm doing a check today because yesterday the microphone was a little trippy. It was like cutting in and out. And I think the reason was I had my USB port unplugged and my iLock wasn't plugged in. I think my auto tune that I had up, it kept muting the audio. So I think that's what happened the other day. I'm just checking to make sure. We all here. Is this the right chat? Hold on, let me pop out the other chat. I don't think this chat's working. Boom, 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 boom. Oh wait, this chat works. There we go. Hassan is here. What's up? It doesn't work. Sorry to see it. Alex 3, what's up? Devin, what's going on? Yevheni Ashtik, what's up? Devin Bailey is here. So it looks like we got you two rocking. To a degree. So in that case, I can change the name of this video. What up? Let me say my hellos real quick. Produced by Jay. Devin's here. RPK is here. It's Pete. Drew Figs. What up? Nancy is here. Nanzi. I'm probably saying that wrong. Marcel, what's up? Methodical Track Bangers. Still rocking. Aditya. I remember that name. Aditya. Shout out to you. Matt Gurus. Thank you for not stopping creating free stuff. Even this. During these hard times. Oh yeah, this is like nothing else to do but do this. So we're gonna be going through FL Studio today. Devin Jones, Evan with a dope beat. Shout out to you. Prince Kingston, like Jamaica. Jacob McDaniel, Rich Hanna. What up, man? Rich Hanna. Always plugging his cousin stuff. Produced by Jay. What's up? Huria or Horaya. I'm probably saying that wrong again. Evan, I said what's up, Evan. Daniel Hamdar. Jacob McDaniel. We have, yeah, Jacob, we shouted you out before, my bad. Oscar Dash. TM with the trademark. There we go. Maskey Official. Maskey Official. Polis Music. This dark mode is kind of easier to read, but kind of not. So forgive my eyeballs here. This stream, yeah, since I know it works, this is going to be, let's edit this title. Shout out to everybody in here. We're going to get to it. I was just making sure the mic wasn't going to cut out for 3 hours straight. This is going to be FL Studio Masterclass Q&A Live. Q&A Live. So it's more than a Q&A. I'm actually going to show you some cool stuff that I learned as I was making beats for the beat battle. I'm going to show you a lot of cool tricks that some stuff I just didn't even know until I checked it out. So we're at 1:47 Eastern Time. Where are you guys from? I already know Bufo is from Sparta, New Jersey. When he joins, Rich Hunt is here. Evan's here. Stereo's here. Let me pull up FL. This looks kind of like Twitch. Anybody watch Twitch? Doesn't this look a lot like Twitch or like the YouTube gaming? They used to have a YouTube gaming thing. Everything's in dark mode. So anyway, shout out to everybody in here. I probably didn't say what's up to a couple folks. Darian is here. We got Cammy here, Diamond Bird. What's up, Charlie Boy's here, and who else is here? Write fire on the beat. That's a definite. Your name is what you're about to do. Write fire on the beat. You guys are from Orlando, Jersey. There we go. Sacramento, California. Had a couple people up near there. Yay, yo, what up, Detroit? Oh my God, Payroll Giovanni, one of my favorite style rappers right now. Vegas, shout out to Vegas. Vegas is expanding. Fort Lauderdale, that's in Florida, right? South Africa. Shout out to everybody from South Africa. I heard that everybody's cool down there. Germany, there we go. Nine. Fort Lauderdale, what's up? We got, who else is in here? Norway? Shout out to Norway. I forgot that was a country, but shout out to you guys. United Kingdom, DC is in the house. Chocolate City. Toronto. Toronto's a very. It's like a clean New York City. That's what Toronto is. UK, originally from India. Shout out to you for being tied to the UK. Prince Edward, Canada. That's a place? Prince Edward, Canada? You guys have a town named after a guy who probably isn't even ex in existence anymore. Iowa, what's up? Manteca, California. Then we're all over the place. There we go. I love that. Sweden is in here. Kazakhstan? Is that the one where, what's that guy's name? Who's that guy that had the mustache and he was a goofy guy and he made a whole movie? Barat, oh, what's his name? Barat. It sounded like Barack. Barat, Brat, Barat, Borat. Borat. That's his name. Borat. I think he was from Kazakhstan. He made a whole movie about that. It was so funny. The Borat character. Antarctica. Yeah, right. You could be, because they have like military base or something down there. India. Shout out to India in the house. The whole country of India. Man, this is before we go live. Let me say something that's super, super probably not said live a lot. Indian families are the most family-oriented families I've ever seen in America. Let me repeat this. In my neighborhood, there's a lot of Indian families, and I respect them so much because I see kids playing outside. I see the parents with their kids. I see the whole family like doing stuff as a family. They taught me like, wow, America has deviated so far from what we used to be that like the people who are coming here from their greater countries are showing us how to be better Americans. Does that make sense? Like that changed my whole perspective about everything. So shout out to Indian families. The reason why they have a low divorce rate in America is because their families have to agree on marrying the two people. So when you meet a girl, you don't just meet the girl. You have to be friends with her family. And her parents have to, you know, vibe with your parents. So like it's a deeper connection than just two people. Just a little random note about Indian culture that I respect. All right, so on to the FL Mastery. So this is going to be dedicated to anything you want to know about FL Studio. This is not me plugging my plugin. I'll talk about my plugin, but this is not about me plugging my plugin. This is just about whatever you want to know about FL Studio. So what I'll do is I'll leave a little dash. You let me know what you want to learn in FL, and we're going to knock it down in like 3 seconds. So let's get it. If you see a dotted line, that means any questions after that line, I'm going to take. And then I'll add another dotted line, and that's going to be the section of questions that we focus on. People still shouting out their hometowns. Let's get it. Guatemala. Oh, Cape Town, South Africa. I heard Johannesburg was pretty cool. Brazil, obrigado. That's what they say. Genada. Obrigado, genada. Ableton, this one, I'll definitely bring those back. Yeah, because now I have time. Patcher plugins, making a beat in live, in Ableton Live, I'm assuming you mean. Automation, we'll do automation, patcher, and I'll go over Hermes when it comes time. Have a question, how do I export stems from the mixer channel that have effects on a bus channel? All right, so this little section of questions, I'm going to pause my chat on the screen, but I'll open up chat on my phone so I can keep up with the chat. Give me a second here. Oh, I have my phone on airplane mode. The reason I go on airplane mode on my phone during streams is because I don't want my phone to eat up the Wi-Fi. So let me turn up the Wi-Fi. Hold up. I got to load my own stream. Howdy up, howdy up, howdy up, howdy up. All right, I'm pulling up the live with you guys. Shout out to everybody in here. 123 people. That's 1, 2, 3. Cool, I got the live chat in front of me. Bang. Okay. So now I got this in front of me, I can keep track of the comments. Okay, so Patcher. Yeah, a lot of people overlook Patcher. The reason being, it's very complicated. It's almost overly complicated. And yes, it will give you the next level of things you could do in FL Studio, but sometimes it's just not worth the time to go through Patcher. But here's what I'll show you. A lot of people overlook this. If you open up Patcher, you can do two main things in Patcher. Patcher is, what's up, Gypsy? Sinaloa, Mexico, Temecula, California. I know all about the Temecula, Irving, is that one? San Diego. I was in Oceanside. There's Carlsbad, I think, is down there. Anyway, so Patcher can be loaded as a plugin, or it can be loaded at, excuse me, a VS. It can be loaded as an instrument, or it could be loaded as an effect. And a lot of people don't realize Patcher has presets. So if you click on this preset, it will load up an already made instrument. So the reason I kind of stay away from Patcher is because it's very complex. Like, okay, so this is the front of the plugin, but if you click the map tool, this is what the engine of the plugin basically looks like. So when you're using Patcher, it can get this complicated. That's why sometimes it's not worth your time to use Patcher, unless you really, really, really just want to learn this stuff. This is like similar to Reactor from Native Instruments. And what it does is you tell FL Studio what to do with MIDI information and audio inputs. And basically, this looks super complicated, but all these things are doing is telling a Harmer what to do. And that seems so like, why would you need all these things to tell Harmer what to do? So some stuff is worth getting into, some stuff isn't. And like for this sound, like really, I loaded this up for this sound. It's just not, you know, it's not worth all this coding time. So that's why I said don't get obsessed with Harmore. But what you can do is open up, Patcher. What you can do is open up Harmore and change out the presets within it and still have all these things applied to that instance of Harmore. So if you don't understand signal flow, none of what I'm saying is going to make sense. But what this is basically doing, real quick, with Oceanside, yeah, I did like Oceanside. It's just one weird thing about California was that it felt like it didn't have a personality. It was just like nice houses, nice neighborhoods, but like no identity. And that was the weird part about Oceanside. So, you know, I mean, it was cool being by myself, but it was like repetitive. It was like being in paradise, but by yourself. So it was like, what's the point? I was missing my family. I was missing my dog. So it's like, what is the point of being in a different state, period? So I just went back to be around family and loved ones. I think that's more important. But yeah, Oceanside was cool. So anyway, you can go through presets within Patcher, and it will load up these kind of pre-built plugins for you, so you don't have to waste time trying to code your own plugin. Then you have to ask again, is it worth And again, you can mess with their custom built knobs. The only weird thing about Patcher, though, with these pre-built plugins, and shout out to all the developers who did make the plugins for Patcher, like Wise Labs did a lot of this stuff. Only issue I have is some of the terminology they use is like very difficult to understand. So that's the difficulty when it comes to using other plugins. They make up their own terminology. You know, so I'm trying to show you the reality of Patcher and the real levels of difficulty, because maybe that will save you a bunch of time trying to learn Patcher. Because learning Patcher, I mean, you have to really know what you're doing, not only in sound design, but in like signal flow and all this type of advanced stuff. This is a chord generator. Let's mess with this thing a little bit. Now this is cool. I wish you could change the sound out though. You probably can. Does it change every time? This is cool, but it's kind of difficult to understand like what this means by the key, what the chord type is picking per note. Like if we look at the map again, this is like the engine of a car. Do I use different DAWs in parallel? I like Ableton Live, but Studio One I use for vocal recordings because it has Melodyne built into it and it actually works. And I use Pro Tools for like if I have to mix something from a studio. So it has this thing. Okay, so this is complicated. I'm just showing you what Patcher actually is so you can understand how much time and energy is going to have to go into you learning. I don't think it's worth learning that deeply, just being honest with you. Okay, because without Patcher, you can't use something called Key Mapper, which is how you build chords per key. So if I play C on my keyboard, it will play like whatever is mapped to C right here. So this is the complexity you can use it for. Maybe we'll get into that if you want to learn about that, but I mean, it's kind of like you can build your own Cthulhu basically with that plugin. Okay, so the next question. Oh, also, I want to show you Patcher in the effects. So, real quick. So, you can load up effects in Patcher as well, and they have built in plugins, like a bunch of plugins actually. And I saved all my versions of the plugins that came with the Ultimate Producer Bundle. I made my own plugins using FL Studio stuff. So we had a vocal mixing plugin. We had an 808 mixing plugin. We have a, what else is in there? Vocal mixing, 808 mixing, a piano and guitar plugin as well. So these are all like my saved files from that. But it has mid-side compression, filters, blah, 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 blah. Bunch of plugins nobody knows about that are in FL Studio. So if you load it up, for example, the Let's do this. This is similar to in Ableton, they have something called Max Live or Max for Live. So Patcher lets people basically create their own plugins with FL Studio stuff. So you can use multi-band compression, stuff that you can't get with the image line built plugins. As is, I mean. So that's what that is. That's what Patcher is. Do I think you need it though? I'm just being straight with you. No. Hey man, hope you're feeling better. Oh yeah, I'm straight. We all good. We all good. Wait, there's more questions in here. Where's the other questions? I feel like I stopped the screen at the wrong spot. Wait a minute. Oh, Patcher plugins making a beat live. Automation. So the question is, what do you want to automate? So let's load up something random. Let's load up Harmore. Let's load up Hermes. Why am I loading up Harmore? So this thing can fit a lot of screens because we made it vectorial. Resizable, whatever the proper term for that would be. So for example, if you wanted to load up a bell, and let's say you wanted to muffle the bell over time, I'll show you how to do this with third-party plugins, because with FL Studio plugins, all you have to do, let me show you. Now it's different with FL, and I wish there was an easier protocol for this, but if you right-click any image line made plugin, you could just right-click, create an automation clip. But when you use third-party plugins or plugins that aren't developed by the DAW creator, you can't just right-click and create automation for stuff. So you have to do it a different way. And that's why I'm showing you this way. So using my own plugin as an example, let's say you have a melody loop going and you wanted it to be muffled. So you wanted to add a low pass filter to it. So let's say you wanted it to muffle to that over time. What you would do is move this knob a little bit, go to your drop down arrow, go to browse parameters. FL Studio will pull up a list of parameters. Now, I think it highlights whatever you move. Yeah, so whatever you move, it will highlight that parameter in the left side. So I'll move frequency because I want to modulate the frequency or automate the frequency. So you right-click, create automation clip. And in FL, you know, I wish stuff was a lot easier, like Ableton and Pro Tools and stuff, but they have their own ways of doing things. So what you have to do is stretch out the automation clip so it's long enough, for one. And you have to make sure your automation clip goes throughout the whole song, because sometimes, let's say you have gross speed on something and you're automating gross speed, it will, if you don't have it know a value, it will automatically assume the last value that it had. So for example, if the last value that it had was to have gross beat on and I reset the song, but like my automation clip was like over here somewhere and I'm resetting the song, FL Studio is going to assume that it's over here somewhere. So it's very, you know, weird way to do automation, but what you got to do is make it long enough, copy the first value, paste the end value, and then you give it values over time. So I wanted that melody to get muffled over time. So what I'll do is I'll drag in the melody sound, and then it will become muffled. It will go from this high frequency. So let's open up the plugin so you can see what's going on. So right now the filter is not on, but over time it's going to slowly go down to this value over time. That's what automation is letting you do, move stuff over time. So let's watch it in real time. So as I'm automating, this thing is telling Hermes to lower this value over time. Okay, so that's what's happening. Okay, so that's what that process is all about. And that's, you know, automation explained in 2 seconds. Now, the problem is sometimes that people's song will be automated without them realizing. So you want to right click, delete the automation, but also you want to go to your browser, go to current project, go to patterns, go to initialize controls, and then right click and delete the event. That will get rid of the automation completely. So again, I'm not sure how FL Studio operates. I don't know why they have it that way to where it doesn't really delete it, but that's the issue a lot of you are having. So what else? We went over automation. How do I export stems from the mixer channel that have effects on the bus channel? You have to update your FL Studio. In short, that's the answer. So let's do this. Now I can't do this live because it'll mess up the audio signal flow, but what you do is you send it to a mixer channel, whatever the sound is. Let me make make this shorter so we don't have to hear it loop. Actually, never mind. Let's do this. Copy and paste. So we fill out the spots. Okay. Now from here, you're going to send your sound to the mixer, whatever number you want. I just found out a shortcut. You hit Alt-M to hide or reveal these numbers on the left side. And what you can do is left click with your mouse and just type in a number. So if you wanted it to go to mixer channel 1, you would just left click and type in 1. And it will automatically go there. It's a quick way to route stuff. If you want Hermes to be on 2, you left click hit 2 on your keyboard. If you want a scalar to be on 3, left click hit 3 or 34, whatever you want. That's a quicker way to do it. Now, there's other ways to route stuff to the mixer. I'm not going to get into a long dissertation about it. So 3X OSC, it's routed to mixer channel 1. So let's open up an effect like Fruity Delay 3. Let's give it a vibe. Let's add some effects here. Let's pull down the feedback and delay time and turn up time modulation. And make sure this is routed to the proper. Oh, you know what? I put that on track 3 by accident and I didn't realize. So if you did that by accident, you would left click hit 3 and then you would swap that one out for that one. So that's a quick way to reroute in FL Studio. Just left click, type the number. So now that you have the effects, what you want to do is there's two different ways to do it. You don't have to do the disc recording way. That's the old way of doing it. What you can do now in FL Studio 20 is go to your playlist. Okay. Then right click on the left side where it says track 1, then consolidate this track from track start. And then what you want to do is open up the miscellaneous tab, because a lot of people on, like myself, not big screen laptops, but laptops with like a high resolution. Shout out to the chat in here. I'm just trying to answer some questions. So save your questions until I add like a little dot, dot, dot. Then I'll take the next piece of questions, because I don't want you to waste a question and think I'm not looking at your questions. We're just trying to block out the question. So see these little lines on the left side? I'm going to put these lines from where I'm going to take the questions, and we'll take all the questions in that box. But real quick, a lot of laptops have high resolution. So what you have to do, I'm in scaled version of FL Studio. So it makes all the stuff bigger because I'm in a high resolution screen. So you go to miscellaneous, because a lot of us can't see the whole thing. So you hit miscellaneous and then activate enable insert effects, and that will render this with the effects from that specific channel. Then you just hit okay, or render, whatever, hit start. I can't do it for the video sake because it messes up the audio and all that type of stuff for the video, but that's how you would do it. All right, so let's take the next batch. Strumming can mean bring, or it can mean ding 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 ding. So I have a video called How to Make Guitar Melodies, and I will watch that because to me, I guess that's picking more than strumming, but well, I don't know. What you could do, I'll give you like one of the shortcuts you probably already know. But guitar is very, you have to remember that it's not just here. Okay, let me show you what I'm trying to say. So a lot of people, is there a plugin I can use in FL with guitar? No, it doesn't matter. So let me give this a pluck. I'm so thorough for no reason, but let me give this an envelope real quick so this makes sense. Not guitar sounding, but hopefully you get the concept. So we're going to play it like it's a guitar. So when you're playing a guitar, pick and strum, there we go, pick and strum. So when you're strumming, you're going down and you're going up. So a lot of people will teach you in FL Studio piano roll to hit Alt S. This does create a strum feature, but it only strums one direction. So here, I just saw something. This is cool. Like your brain picks up stuff. I didn't even realize this. This might be the answer here. So let's hit Alt S. It pulls it. Can you see it? My head might be in the way. Hold on. Oh no, my head's straight. Pause. So you pull up the strummerizer and you mess with the time strength. This is going to tell it which direction, whether it goes bring, like from low notes to high notes, or if it goes from high notes to low notes. So you can tell it which direction you want it to go. Velocity just makes the notes sound different, just in case you have velocity sensitivity in a plugin. And what that means is, usually when people sample guitars and stuff, they'll sample you hitting it really soft, you hitting it a little bit harder, really hard, and they have different sounds. So this is what the velocity meter will let you do. Now I'm curious if the alternate direction will. Oh wow, this is the answer, I think. Let me see. So let's turn this up and then hit alternate direction. You know what? You guys just gave me a new YouTube video to thank you. I never realized that was there. So that's cool. And let's see what this feature does. Let me see something here. Let's see what chop chords does. Alt S, hit alternative direction. So it's you're strumming up and then strumming down on a guitar. But the thing is, you're not always strumming up or down. Sometimes you're strumming up twice or down twice. But for the most part, up and down strum. What does chop chords do though? Huh, I wonder what chop chords does. I don't know what that does. But it looks like it does something cool. So I would even mess with this knob here, the strength knob, how long the notes last. Because when you're playing guitar, you're strumming, you're not holding notes. There's so much detail to go into this. Just use Alt S and mess with this stuff, okay? And hit alternate direction. So now it will sound like this. Let me slow this down a little bit. Definitely doesn't sound like a guitar because I'm using the wrong sound. Let me pull up. I'm trying to think of a guitar that's not built to be a guitar. Maybe Expand 2 will have it. Because a lot of the plugins I was going to pull up, they have like smart features in it that strum it for you and all that. I don't want all that. Let's just pull up a guitar sound. Let's go to guitar. Go to acoustic. So now with the strumming feature, let's do a before and after type of thing. So we did, what is a C, E, G. And it's wrong note. Let's pull these to the right. This will be the after, and then we'll create a before. So here's what kind of amateurs do. They just play the notes as if it were a piano. You got to remember, a guitar is not a piano. Let me take off this effect. Hold on. See how it sounds a little bit different now in FL Studio? The notes that are overlapping will be masked, so you need to pull that back. See how it feels a little bit more real? Maybe this sound is a little weird though. Or it might be the chorus. That's probably what it is. Hold on. No, it's the sound itself. See how it sounds more real in the second half? At least closer to real, not super real, but. So Alt S, again, this is the shortcut, and then, oops, I hit Alt A by accident, Alt S, and then hit alternate directions if you're going to do guitar. That way you'll have a strum up and a strum down. So shout out to FL for having all these shortcuts we never thought we'd need until now. All right, let's take some new questions. So here again, I'll make a little mark, little dash, dash, dash. And then if you can copy and paste your question, we'll take about like 5 questions at a time so that we can handle this stuff. You uploading type beats? Oh, you're talking to Code. My fault. I was interrupting your whole conversation. When did you start producing? At 14. How do you make vocals sound like they're underwater? I'll show you a secret. It's deeper than a low pass filter, but I'll show you a secret. What's the best way to make your beat hit hard? Good question. Tips on song structure. Okay, that's about 5 questions. So Hermes is coming out this Friday. I finally have the official installers for Mac and Windows. So I'm excited. I just have to finish the sales page for it to show you everything that's inside. And then hopefully it will be ready by Friday. So what does it say? How do you make vocals sound like they're underwater? Okay, let me show you an advanced technique first, and then I'll show you the easier way to do it second, just in case I confuse you too much. Trying to think. FL, let's go to PAX. Actually, they don't have any cool vocals. Let's go to, I think, did she give us vocal? Yeah, she did. So let's go to the free. Oh, you know, my thing is in the E drive. I think it's like the D drive or something. Hold up. E drive. What does that say? E Friends Power Pack. Hold on. I got to let FL reread because I unplugged my hard drive, so I gotta tell it which directory to look into. Which thing is it? Friends Power Pack. Here we go. Sounds. This should be E, not D. I mean D, not E. think it's the D drive. Hit that. No, it's not the D drive. What is it? Is D? Is it E? We did E. Let's try F. Hold on, guys. I got to do some geeky computery stuff to find this folder real quick because my stuff changed its location. Not F either. Let me just be ghetto and open up my whole situation. Hold on. I got to mute my screen for a second. So where was the E drive? Watch it be like H or something crazy. It is the, hold up, it's File Explorer. Takes its good old time. H, it's the H drive, really? H? Okay, it's the H drive. My fault. Let's pull this up. So if you, I'm glad this pulled up, because if you guys didn't know, if your sounds like disappear from the browser, you have to tell FL Studio to look into the proper folder. So chances are you took out your USB port and it changed the actual directory of the stuff. So you just have to change the letter right here. You don't have to like import all the folders manually. You just have to change the letter to the proper letter. So it's H. Okay, geeky stuff done, reread. And it didn't do nothing. Maybe I have to hit enter. Maybe that's why. Enter. Oh, that's probably why. There we go. For the eighth time. What did it say? Eighth time is the charm. Okay, so Ivan gave us some vocals for free. These are the things I gave out for free during the beat battle for people who watched. Only for the people who watched live. So these are not out anywhere. Okay, so she gave us some vocal stuff. That's pretty dope. Let's grab this. So it says 70 BPM. Let's go to 70 times 2 is, my math is bad. I think that's 140. Correct me if I'm way wrong. So we're going to go to channel settings, go to mode, stretch mode. Make sure you stretch your vocal to where it needs to be if you're going to do it the way I'm doing it right now. This is just so that it locks in with the tempo. If you're going to drag in any acapella. Okay, so one way to make it sound underwater is to go to the sample in the top left with your pencil tool. Go to channel settings. Now, once you see your sampler window, right click and go to edit in audio editor. Okay, now you want to select the whole sample, hit control A, right click, go to format, go to edit properties. This is what Drake does, by the way. I'm just letting you know a Drake technique. Go to format. And then go to sample rate and lower this down to 16,000, excuse me, hertz. Hit resample and then hit accept. So this is basically going to take out all the high frequencies of the vocal. So what you do from here, drag it back into the sampler. And then now if we listen to it, it won't have as many high frequencies as before. Let's compare it to the original. Just to show you the difference. So let's do the affected one first and then the original second. So this should be the same length. See how the original is very bright? That's not necessarily an underwater effect. It's more of how to take out higher frequencies. And I'll even show you the frequency response. That's probably a better way to understand this. Load up Wave Candy if you want to look at frequency stuff. Wave Candy is a slept on plugin. This is probably one of the best plugins for understanding sound design. So anyway, so when I talk, I have a bunch of different frequencies. That purple at the top, those are really high frequencies, but they're very faint. So anything that's yellow is really intense. Anything that's red is kind of in between, and anything purple is very faint. So when I say S, there's a lot of high frequencies. Whereas if I say ooh, it's a lot of lower frequencies. And what you're doing with the technique I just showed you is lowering the sample rate. So the computer can't, what it's doing is reading the sample at a slower. Okay, so imagine taking 48,000 pictures of a sound wave and then drawing the curves that way. You're gonna have more accuracy and more curvature. But if I have 16,000 snapshots, I can only calculate up to a certain frequency because I can't see the frequency because I'm not taking enough snapshots. So that's what's happening with the sample rate being lowered, it can't calculate to those, it can't see the higher frequencies. And that's what we're doing with this vocal. So I'm going to play the first vocal that's affected with the lo-fi effect, and then play the second one. So the low, the first one, you'll see the effect, you'll see that there's not a lot of high end, and then the second one, you'll see the high end come back. So let me mute my mic so you don't get the interference here. So you see this whole like cloud of stuff? That's what's being added back. Okay, so that's what we're taking out using that sample rate reduction technique. Now, to do the underwater effect, you're probably talking about a low pass filter. So a low pass filter allows low frequencies to pass. Some people call it a high cut. So you'll hear the two different names referring to the same exact thing. So a high cut means you're cutting out high frequencies. A low pass means you're allowing the lows. So let's add a filter to this. Again, left click, hit the number you want in the mixer. I want this on track one. Left click, hit one. All right, so let's open up insert one, and let's open up Fruity Parametric EQ 2. Okay. Now let's left click, switch this right side to a low pass filter shape. Okay, so depending on how muffled you want it, you can left click this little dot at the bottom to make this curvature sharper. And then you left click where it says frequency and you pull it down. And that's really good if you want to just like background vocals, because the issue is that a lot of people who use vocals as creative parts in their song, they're too bright and they compete with the main vocal. So you have to cut out the high end so it doesn't compete with the main vocal. And that's what you can do. So for example, with this, we can use, let's use one on one track, one on the other. So what I want to do with this one is lower the octave so it sounds like a male. So let's pull it down an octave, left click and drag. Now without that filter, it would sound like this. It would sound very buzzy and kind of in the way, especially if you layer the two. But with the filter, you can tuck it so it's not competing. And then you can layer them so you don't have to pan them out. And then they don't get in the way of each other. So that's how you do that. And da, da, da. So that's how you do the underwater effect. I'm not sure if you're referring to the that effect. What you would do is, if you want that effect, you add resonance. It's called, or bandwidth, here in FL Studio's Parametric EQ2. You left click and drag this. Well, let me mute the other one. So if you want more like Bryson Tiller underwater effect, just mess with this resonance knob. It just adds an EQ boost that makes certain frequencies stand out. So that's what a lot of R&B vibes is high resonance with a low pass filter. Also, I think Fruity Love Filter has a preset. If you want that Mike Will Made It, that I forget the plugin. I think it's Love Filter. Somebody probably knows in the chat. I don't use this plugin, but it's good if you want to create automation for a filter. So again, we're going over a lot of high level stuff. Chances are you're not going to be using this half the time, but you can experiment with this. I forget the preset that Mike Will uses, but somebody probably knows. Just go through the presets one by one. It's in there somewhere. I think it's, or it might be Fruity Filter, one of those plugins. I'm pretty sure it's Love Filter. What's the best way to make your beat hit hard? So let's pull up, let's make a song out of this. Might as well. Okay, so one is getting the right samples. So let me kind of contrast it. If you use Let's go to drums. Let's actually go to legacy. Legacy drums. And let's go to something that's not dance. We need like an acoustic genre. Real drum kits. Let's find a kick drum. A lot of these have bass, but let's do this one. Okay, so I'll show you how to make your kicks hit harder. And then I'll compare it to a random sample. So my point is that once you learn how to make kick sound harder, it doesn't always apply to every single kick. So let's open up this folder and go to Split Mind. And in here they have the BWB. This is not my kit. This is Big White Beats. He has some really good kicks in here. So let's go to kicks. See how they're already hitting from the jump? But that's because he knows a secret. So if you drag this kick in, and I know I'm getting a little esoteric, so forgive me if I sound like I'm going too over your head with this. You can let me know. Steve Boston, what up? I got to look down at the chat because the screen is paused on the question. So shout out to everybody in here. So if you look at a lot of Murder Beats kicks and stuff, or whomever's kicks, you'll see that the image doesn't even fit within the sampler. That means that they turned up the sample in volume. Because if you hit normalize, the same kick looks like this. Now, it's still punchy, but it's not as punchy. So if you turn it off of normalize, it goes like that. So let me show you how to normalize. Basically lets you get the levels to where they're not clipping, but you're still getting the waveform. Okay, so let's start at normalization. You don't have to do it for every sample. I'm just showing you where the sound source is starting from. So the sound source compared to the other sound source already sounds punchier. This sounds more like lightweight with no low end really. Whereas this kick sounds more synthetic and sine wave based and square wave based. So what you do is you open up your mixer, open up Fruity Soft Clipper, turn up your threshold, and you don't have to mess with the post knob if you don't want. Now what you do is you pull down your fader and then you go back to your kick sample and just turn up the volume. So so start with the channel volume for one, then go to your sampler, go to your wrench tool and turn up level adjustment volume. See how the kick's hitting harder? Now you adjust your fader. Now the kick's hitting super hard. So here's a before. We can't really do a before and after, because I would have to undo this, but here's before, kind of lightweight, and here's after. Okay, so some people in FL20, they use the pre-computed effects. I don't like these because it distorts the plugin. It distorts the sound because they put it on clip. See how it squared it off right here? We don't want that squarey sound. Okay, for example, if you take off Fruity Soft Clipper and use the pre-computed effects and go to clip mode, it will square off the sound. But you can also boost the sound into the clip mode. So you can see clip mode visually shows us what's happening. As we're turning up the boost, it's sending more and more signal into basically a limiter that's hard cutting the sound off into a square wave. So it's taking those smooth sine wave curves and just cutting off the tops. And it makes a square wave, and square waves have higher harmonics than a sine wave. Sine wave has those super bassy low end, whereas square waves have the higher frequencies. So a good kick usually has a combination of both. Now this sounds cool, but it doesn't, sounds a little weak. And if you turn the boost up, it just doesn't sound hard. It just sounds crunchy. It's not the same exact thing as running it through a Fruity Soft Clipper. So if you run it through a Fruity Soft Clipper with the volume up, I don't know. To me, it has a more rounded off sound. I would have to test them side by side to look at the harmonics and see which one. So that's how you make your drums hit harder. And that's half the battle. And another thing is turn your headphones up. Okay, so turn your headphone volume up and then turn your stuff down in FL Studio down. So turn your headphones up and then turn your mixer stuff down and then start mixing from there. Because a lot of people, they'll have their headphones low and then they'll start mixing with everything with their faders all the way up, and then there's no room, there's no dynamic range, it's called. Keep doing this. How do you reset all these at once? Wish there was a. There probably is a button. I don't know that button. I know that you could right click and hit E. That probably would have done it too. But anyway, so that's what you need to know about leveling to get your beat to hit harder. That's the problem. You're not leaving enough headroom. It's called. So turn up your headphones and then turn your faders down. You're gonna get a better result. What's the? Oh, I answered that one. Tips on song structure, finishing ideas. I think every song starts with a part A and then like a part B. So right now we're working on part A. But then at some point during the song, something has to change. So maybe I'll make this unique as a sample. Let's not do a sample, let's make it unique. And then maybe I'll time stretch this to double the length to make it sound weird. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So maybe this will be section 2 over here. It has to be some type of contrast. Let's make this unique. And contrast means different in some type of way. Let's go to, we're on stretch mode. Let's stretch this out. Or maybe you could reverse this section or chop it up. You could do interesting things. And let's grab that slip tool, slide this over. And let me reverse both and just slide them at once. Hold on. Reverse this. So your song just really needs two main sections. You don't have to obsess about structure right now, because when you're, as long as you have a place where the intro of the song is there, the hook area is there, and the verse area is there, it doesn't really matter the structure, because they can go in the Pro Tools and chop stuff up and move it around. It's just better that you give them, okay, an intro, hook, verse two, hook. We really don't use bridges as much for hip hop. So you don't have to be so worried about arrangement, because people aren't consuming songs the way they used to consume songs anymore. But it's good to know arrangement just to have that arsenal of creativity. So this would be your part two of the song, whereas part one is like this. And then maybe you can add some effects during the second half of the song. Let's tie this together. Let me show you how to automate this. So you would hit control, left click, and highlight these in the mixer, right click, and route to this track only. So both of these vocals are going to track 3, where we're going to have the effects. And I'm going to add this like chorusy feedback delay. Okay, so let's right click, create automation clip on the mix level of Fruity Delay 3. And we want it off in the beginning, so set the value to 0. And then we want it on for the second half. So right click, add that value, and make it completely on. So it won't affect the first half, but it will affect the second half. So the goal is to create contrast, 2 different sections. Sidechaining your kicks and stuff? Okay. Let me write that down. The point is that it's 2 different sections. Okay, so hopefully I made that make sense. Did I answer all the questions in this block? I've been procrastinating making music for the past 6 hours. That's not a long time. How do you stay focused and get over the starting a new project fear and perfectionism? I think what it is Hassan, you got to make in your life clear working hours and clear resting hours. A lot of us don't really fully rest and unplug. And a lot of us don't fully work. We're like half on our phone, half working, half. And when we're resting, we're half thinking about work. So there's never a full rest or full work. That's half the battle. The other half is that you have to realize your body is only going to focus at 4 hours at a time. So, you know, this is my 4 hours of focus time from, when did we start this stream? How long have we been on here? Been on here for, where do you find the time? That's not it. Where's the time? I don't know where to find the time, but however long we've been on since 1:45. Okay, so about an hour. So we've been on since for about an hour. So for example, I know if I started my working day about an hour, I know I have 3 more hours to go before I have to like take a break. And then then you can really just chill. You can play video games for 4 hours. And when you get in this flow, you don't have to be, you don't have to feel guilty for rewarding yourself, giving yourself free time. Now, unless you're at a job that forces you to be at a desk and all this type of stuff, that's how you become actually more productive than the person who just tries to hit out 8 hours every single day without any structure to it. So that's how you're, that's why a lot of you guys who take jobs that you don't want. I used to work at Goodwill and we used to work 8 hours straight. The problem with that, the reason you're so exhausted is not just because you worked 8 hours. It's because you were, you had that high focus for 4 hours and you never took that 4 hours of reciprocated downtime. So now you're like doubly not resting, and it just multiplies and multiplies and multiplies until you're so beat down that you don't even want to do bigger things. And that's what happens with a lot of jobs. Let's take some more questions in the little box thing. So after the line, I'll take some questions. So if you just joined, copy your question and then get ready to paste it when we have these little line things. Technically, any type of clipping. You could try clipping, but you got to be careful with all types of clipping on low end, because you're going to lose a lot of the low end if you distort it a certain way. Okay, these questions here look cool. Do you think Waves is a scammy company? They are selling all their products for about $30. I was going to get some plugins, but I hear they charge a lot for the updates. One time I will say that I thought I had to update to use my plugin, and it tricked me in a way to where I had to buy. I forget what I did, but I didn't realize you couldn't do it this other way. So I basically spent $400 that I didn't have to spend, just being tricked because I've updated the plugins that I didn't need to update. Some weird thing about updates, I forget how it worked. But yeah, I did feel like at that time it was a little misleading, but they've updated their technology since. I just don't deal with Waves because of how they compensate the people bringing them business. I don't think it's good business, and I think it's greedy in a sense. So that's why I was talking about Waves the other day. Right, okay, our Mick or Mike, probably Mike. How do you tune piano sounds to make a dark, mean hip-hop melody? So it comes down to scales. So in the music theory essentials, we have something called a scale code. Let me see if I can find it. I don't know if I have it saved in my camera roll. It might be in here somewhere. But different scales have different moods. Let me see if I can find it real quick. It's worth me going through my folder. So for example, the major scale has a happier mood. The minor scale in general has a sadder mood. Different modes have different moods. You have I think it's Dorian. Dorian has a Spanish-y vibe. It has a bluesy vibe. And it has I forget the other vibe to it. But that's the scale that Cardi B's song was in. So little stuff like that. If you didn't know, it generates mood. So it's based on the scale. And scales can be deeper. Where is this graphic? I swore it was easy to find. To find here. It's not all the way back here, is it? Yeah, it is. Okay. Here's a scale book. I don't know what you can see, so let me make this a little bit bigger. So we call this scale codes. Oh, wait. This is locked. Hold on. Transform fit screen. Okay. Forgive my gym clothes here. I didn't really prepare for today. So scale codes will give you the mood. I don't know if you could. Let me do this again. So we have the moods associated with the scale. I don't know why my cam's not focusing. Focus. Whatever. Anyway. Oh, there you go. So the major scale has a happy mood. The natural minor scale has a dark, eerie mood. What is this? Harmonic minor has an enchanted mood. Melodic minor, sad and happy at the same time. Blues scale is very tense. Whole tone scale is very confusing sounding. The major pentatonic is cheerful and the minor pentatonic is cheerful. We also have something called mode codes, and this is all included in the music theory essentials. I'm just showing you what it looks like. Come on, Cam, work for me, man. So the Aeolian mode has a dark mood. Locrian mode, dark mood. Ionian, which is also C major, has a happy mood. Dorian has lazy? I can't read from back here. Jazzy, sorry. Durian has a jazzy mood. Phrygian, not Dorian. I meant to say Phrygian. Phrygian has like a trappy Spanish sound to it. Lydian mode has a dreamy ethereal sound to it. And then Mixolydian has mysterious bluesy vibe to it. And you could download those right to your phone with the Music Theory Essentials. So that's what comes in there. Let me make myself smaller. So that those moods are behind every single scale. So your question was, how do you create a, what was it? How do you create, okay, a dark, mean hip-hop melody? So if I want a dark, mean, I would go to my modes, codes, and scale codes. Let me find it again. I should have had it up. You said dark and eerie. So that would mean, so I would look on the charts and look for dark and eerie. Dark, eerie. I had one that said eerie. Let me find it here. You actually said the two were, so I said eerie. You said dark and mean. So we would use the natural minor scale. So the natural minor scale, if you don't know what that is, in FL Studio, you can pull it up. So let's open up Hermes, for example. And this is my plugin about to come out on Friday. Hopefully I'll have everything situated by Friday. So let's, it has a bell sound. Let's take that bell sound, go to piano roll. Now, I wouldn't like really rely on FL Studio for this because you sometimes, especially if you don't know music theory, you can accidentally pick the wrong thing and then you'll be producing in the wrong scale. But click the drop down, go to helpers, go to scale highlighting, and then you have to know what these mean. That's the issue most people have. So natural minor is the scale you have to pick for that dark mean vibe. So now FL Studio is going to tell you the notes for that dark mean vibe. The only thing you also have to do is set the root note for the key. So let's say you wanted to do it in F minor. Okay. So now FL Studio is going to, the lighter notes are within the scale. So you just follow the notes that are light. So if you wanted to create a dark melody, and but again, there's so much to teach you about music theory here because your question seems simple, but it's very complex. Another part about melody, it's not always what scale you use. It's the way you create your melody. So for darker vibes, go downward in your melody. If you want happier vibes, go upward in your melody. That's the quick way to understand melody. So let's start at F and let's go down the scale. And all I'm doing is playing the notes in the scale going down. And let's go to F. And then again, you got to trapify the melody. So you would add halftime and delay effect. Now this sounds kind of like the melody's cheesy because it's just going down a scale. Let me make it a little more interesting. Another big mistake, a lot of people don't leave gaps in their melody. Also, there's so much to teach you about everything. I'm going way deeper than your question at this point. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's add a fourth. The melodies is all over the place, but hopefully you get the concept. Then you would add Fruity Delay 3. It's more about the effects too. That's why your question is so deeper than what you probably thought. Because modern melody is not just what notes you play, it's the effects you play too. You would lower your feedback, lower delay time, turn up time modulation. Then turn your dry level down. This creates the Travis Scott effect. But in Hermes, you don't have to do that. There's a built-in vibrato knob. You just turn this up. Then you could use the plugin to make it sound cooler. Now you have a melody that sounds like Travis Scott. So it all starts with the scale, but then you have to know how to like take it further and further and further. Daniel asks, are you Daniel from the stream with Frank? Because I remember that last name, it seems like. For beat drops, do you use a kick or an 808? I think the beat, when it drops, because I did this a lot for the battle beats, I can't pull them up because of YouTube. I use samples in it. So I will say kicks give it the final, like, we're into the beat because it adds the punchy energy, whereas 808s aren't always punchy. Sometimes they're just bassy. They're not really punchy. So I would say, excuse me, the song might drop into an 808, but then eventually if you want the energy to go higher, add a kick drum. So that's my quick answer to you. We have a beat drop video on our channel. Just type in beat drop, Busy Works Beats. Janice Zell asks tips for making chorus hit harder after intro. Or else, or anyone else, or everywhere else, please. Wait, tips for making chorus hit harder after intro. A couple things you could do in arrangement, or I wish I had more blocks to work with here, but here's the one I do a lot. Firstly, don't use bass in the intro. That's the key. You gotta introduce bass during the hook. That's not a hard rule, it's something I like to follow. Also, I'll change my snap to grid to like a beat. I'll zoom in, and then in song mode, I'll take out just that last beat before the before the beat drops. So I'll just grab that last thing and just cut it out. Now, halftime is making it continuously go. So what you would do is you right click, consolidate this track from track start, make it an audio wave. Let me do that. Just I have to do it my way through Edison. This is only because I'm recording on video. You don't have to do it this way. But let me record it into Edison real quick. Okay, let's pause it, double click, send to playlist as an audio clip, and then I can get rid of Edison. All right, so now I have it in audio form. It's a lot more cool to work with anyway. So again, zoom in, change your snap to grid to that beat mode, grab your slice tool, and if you have a lot of tracks, you can hit shift, left click, and just drag all the way down to however many tracks you need. And then hit shift and right click, and then drag. And it will cut whatever is small in between those two cut points. Oh, I forgot this routes itself back to the channel, so let's turn these effects off. See how the effects stopped completely? It's because it's in audio form now. It's not reading the MIDI. That's a little quick trick. I do that a lot for 808s, kicks, anything. And then bring in your 808 during the hook or bring in your kick during the hook. That's really all a drop needs is a good kick or 808. Or cut out just that piece right before it. That's what's going to make it sound a little bit different. Then you can throw in the pensado tricks. Like if you have a vocal, you can you can automate the volume and make it just a little bit louder in volume, stuff like that. But we're not really talking about mixing. You're talking about making the beat. Will you do a follow-up to how to get a girlfriend video? Good question. I think I laid out all the principles to it in that one video just to give people good filters to use in order to screen out better potential relationships. Because I think it's really important that people have filters. If you don't have filters, anything and everything is going to come into your life and you're going to be attracting people you don't want. Jimmy Mac says, do you use the harmonic minor scale a lot? Probably. I don't obsess about what scale I'm using because I just pick the notes I like, and then whatever scale it is, it's that scale. You have to remember, where does the scale come from? A scale is just a sequence of notes that people like in a certain order. So somebody liked the notes in an order and they're like, let's name this major. But the first step to that was putting the notes in that order. So I think the brain overrides the technique here as far as like using a harmonic scale. But to answer you, no, I probably use the C minor a lot. I use C minor because that's a lot of R&B is built in C minor, or G minor is for pop music. And then you have for trap, it was a Dorian mode. I just forget the key. I want to say, or was it Phrygian? Now my brain's kind of forgetting. It's either Dorian or Phrygian. I forget. We teach it in our Music Theory Essentials. But that's what the scale modes, scale codes, and mode codes are for. Da-da-da-da-da. Do you recommend the FL Studio Transient Processor? No. I bought it, but I don't use it. Kilohertz, I've never used theirs. But no, I like the SPL Transient Designer. I like the SPL version. Also, Native Instruments has one called Transient Master. That one's all right, too. Not sure the price, though. Let's add some more questions. So copy your Dr. Love, hilarious. Dithering. You're asking something about minutia. It's kind of like when you're cleaning a room, should you get every speck of dust off the desk? That's kind of like the question about dithering. We don't, maybe mastering engineers care about dithering and all that little nuanced stuff to justify their job. But for average folks, if you're getting that deep into dithering, then, you know, I mean, it's such a subtle, minute thing that doesn't make or break. It's just simply to understand how files are converted. So when you go from like a high file, oh, you said, what is dithering? I'm sorry, Richon, I read that wrong. What is dithering? So dithering is when you, it adds noise to the file so that when your file goes from a big file to a smaller file, it doesn't have as much curvature to it. So the noise is there to try and counteract the encoder so that it doesn't lose its fidelity, basically going down to a lower quality. That's what dithering is for. There's different types of dithering. I'm not a master at understanding dithering, but I just know that it's such a minute thing that it's something cool to know, but it doesn't make or break anything. Are there any headphones that specifically focus on low end so we can mix it without monitors? My room isn't treated. To answer your question there, every pair of headphones and Sonar Works did a study about this. On average, every pair of headphones is at least, so for example, if you bought these same exact headphones, the Sennheiser HD600s, I like these a lot. But if you bought the same exact pair, it doesn't mean you're going to hear the same exact thing that I'm hearing, because every model of headphone has about 3 dB of variation. So 3 dB is a big, that's a lot, you know. So for example, for me, I could hear 60 hertz sitting where it's sitting. But for you, 60 hertz could be boosted up a little bit and it could sound way louder than what it is. So it doesn't really matter about the model of headphones, but these are good Sennheiser HD600s. At first, I had the Sennheiser HD598s that lasted me for a while. Then I upgraded to these. But I wouldn't obsess either about calibrating your headphones. These headphones were calibrated by SonarWorks, but only if you use the SonarWorks plugin called like Reference or something that it's called. It's called SonarWorks Reference. I don't use that plugin anymore. But what it would do is help you understand your headphones bias, because every headphone and speaker has a certain frequency response. It's not all completely flat. So it means that you're hearing certain frequencies louder than other frequencies. So you're it's kind of like putting on glasses and it having a subtly purple tint. So everything around you, you think is pink and purple, but in reality, if you take the glasses off, it's blue. So the same thing goes with your headphones. So that's my answer to you. Your room isn't treated. My room isn't treated. But the thing about speakers, though, is that it lets you understand depth and like the feeling of a track. The only thing you can't do on headphones is depth and feeling. You cannot feel the song in your ears. You have to feel it in a room. That's the only difference. But I would highly recommend headphones because they just have so many more advantages. Speakers when you can, because you have to worry about the neighborhood you're in. You have to worry about the type of speakers you get, the acoustic treatment. There's so much more that comes with buying speakers than just buying a pair of speakers and calling it a day. Chef asks, what's your opinion on the Kyle Beats plugin? And when I make melodies, I go more off sounds and feel than hard theory. Oh, you go off more off sounds. I see what you mean. Like you start off with a vibe first. That's probably what you're getting at, the vibe. That's why I made Hermes. All these sounds were custom made and custom curated for you. And all the sounds have a vibe, every single one. And you can hear the difference between these sounds and like sounds from some other standard library somewhere. It's because they all have a vibe made by a real human who actually makes modern music. So that's why they have a vibe though. Kyle Beats plugin, I think it was called the Sauce at one point, but he had to change the name. So I didn't use the plugin. I don't know what it sounds like. He didn't tell me about the plugin. I learned about it through a YouTube video. So, I mean, I've never used it before. It's cool that he's making plugins. I want to see more of producers making a bunch of cool stuff. Merch lines. Like, I want to wear you guys' merchandise. I have a hoodie from the Blap Chat member, Perfection, in the other room. And it says, no one's perfect. Like, I like wearing producer-made stuff. I like using producer-made software. I wish producers made headphones. I wish producers made mics. I wish we made laptops and all this type of stuff. We're going to get there over time. Carlo asks, can you explain what compressors and limiters do? That's a very broad question, but compressors, they, the same way auto-tune, put it this way. Let me add auto-tune to my voice. Check. Let me add in a key. So you hear how my voice is like locking into a note? Caught my throat there. That's what compression is doing in one way. It's making everything seem unified. And when you're, without digging too deep into what stereo actually is, because stereo is one speaker playing one thing, another speaker playing the same thing, but playing the different information from both speakers. So they're playing two different things unless they're the same. Mono is a complete illusion that your brain creates. Because if you turn off the left speaker and there's just the right speaker, mono disappears. So mono is this imaginary place. And what a compressor does is make your brain... I think of an easy way to explain this. A compressor makes your brain not see the differences between two things. In a very broad sense, it makes you not understand that the volume's going like this. So the compressor just tries to make the volume stay a little bit stable like this. So your brain will interpret that information of stability a lot differently than if the volume's going all over like this. So in short, that's what a compressor is doing. It's just stabilizing things. And a limiter makes stuff louder for the most part. They have multiple functions, but those are the main functions. A compressor just stabilizes it so that your brain can interpret it as, like, when your brain understands something is not changing, you interpret it differently. Like, I don't know, you just have to do it for yourself. Just what I would do though is find a compressor of any sort and just push it really hard. Like, run your vocals really deeply through the compressor. Let me turn this compressor on. So you would just pump your vocals through this compressor. Turn the ratio up higher. So you can see now my vocals are being like dipped out. So what it's doing is just lowering the volume so that it creates a stable level, stable volume. So just mess with the knobs until you hear it and then pull it back. That's, I know that was like a broad explanation, but compression can do a lot. Limiting can do a lot. Evo says, or asks, limiter slash other plugins or volume pass automation for sidechain? Limiter or other plugins or volume pass automations for sidechain? Maybe you're talking about like when a kick hits and you lower the volume. That's also called ducking. They use that in radio because in radio, when you're talking and you have a song in the background, you don't want the song in the background to compete with the main talker. So every time the speaker talks into the microphone, it will lower the volume of the music, the background music. That's called ducking. So that's what a compressor does for the most part in a radio scenario. So what can I show you today? Where's our audio? Here it is, I think. What was I showing you here? Sidechaining. So another way to do sidechaining is not what you think. It's not using a compressor. So what I can use is a gross beat. If you're in FL Studio, go to the yellow part, not the green part, the yellow part, and then just grab this knob, change it to a bigger chunk, like 1/4, and then right click and create a single curve. So this is essentially sidechaining without any trigger. This is, what's that other plugin called? I want to call it like the LFO tool, or I think there's another one. I think it's called the LFO tool. But this is basically what the LFO tool does. It just lowers the volume manually and pulls it back up. So you can create your own sidechain shapes instead of the shape being based off of a trigger, which is what sidechain usually is. So let me exaggerate this so you can hear it. So the volume is going lower. Now your only task at this point is to get your attack setting so it fits into the groove of the song. So you don't need to sidechain a kick or anything to it. But if you wanted your, like if you're doing lo-fi and you wanted your like, you wanted your kicks and snares to sidechain your sound, you would have to, let's grab a kick. I think we have a kick in here somewhere. Yeah, we do. Let's grab this kick. Let's make it a little bit lighter. Okay, so you have to have the kick on its own track and then the other thing on its other track. So you open up Fruity Limiter on the thing that you want the volume to go down on. Go to compressor mode, okay? And then go back to your kick. Find your kick and then right click on the track's up arrow at the bottom and go to sidechain to this track. Wherever you wanna, whatever sound you wanna duck. Go to that track now, go back to the Fruity Limiter, open up the compressor mode. Under sidechain, you have to insert what's called a key. So right click and pick your kick track. In that case, it's track 4. Now we have to turn on the plugin. And why is the plugin not on? Let's drag this in here. And go back to Fruity Limiter and then lower your threshold. So it's about negative 30 dB is a good spot. Turn your ratio all the way up and then mess with your attack knob. So this attack knob is similar to in Gross Beat, how you move that attack knob. It's basically just moving that starting point. So just move this up. So that lets the kick lower the volume of that melody while the kick plays. That way it can hear it. So it's a style too. It's not just a mixing technique. It's a style of sound, especially in lo-fi. Remy asks, I watch lots of videos about mixing sub bass and kicks, but even sidechaining and equalizing doesn't give me every clean. Da, 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 da. Well, one, you need just better samples. So here's what I meant to get to earlier that I forgot. So this kick right here is not built for trap. And it's not going to be built for trap because of sound selection. This kick is just naturally has the frequencies and the style of sound to be. Maybe you have to rewind the live stream because I talked about how to turn the volume up. Real quick, I'll do a real quick recap. I'll speak at 2x speed. Okay, guys, load a kick that's more punchy. So notice that before you hit normalize here, the kick is like not even in the screen. So you hit normalize. So all they're doing is turning the volume up. So I'm showing you by normalizing the sound. Now you have to open up on the kick track a Fruity Soft Clipper. Turn up your threshold. Turn down your fader and go back to your kick and then turn up the channel volume. And then you'll also have more volume knobs under the wrench tool if you turn up level adjustment. And just find that sweet spot. That's going to make your kicks hit harder. Now let's do the same exact thing for this other kick that's not built for trap. Send it to track 4. And let's do the same exact thing. Let's turn up the channel volume. Go to your wrench tool and let's turn up the volume. You don't even get anything that sounds anything like a trap kick, but we did the same exact thing to it. And that's what I mean by some kicks are built for trap, some aren't. So it does start with the source, the sound source, but it's also not just the sound source, it's also pushing the volumes a little bit higher. That will eliminate like 90% of your kick issues with your 808. It's just turning, making your kick punch harder. Also, turn up your headphone mix or your headphone knob, okay? And then turn down your faders. This will let your brain interpret punch differently. So then you can start turning up the volumes one by one. So if I'm turning up my headphones, the kick's a lot louder. So I'm like, I'm not gonna keep pushing it up in volume because it's super loud in my headphones. So that's a good spot for that kick. Then you would grab an 808. Let's layer this 808 on top. But see, the problem right now is that the 808 is playing at the wrong volume. That's why you guys don't feel the punch in your 808s. It's playing too loudly. So if you pull it down, it's going to hit right because the kick is the punch of the 808 and the body of the 808 is the bass. Also, this 808 is long, so it doesn't have much, you can't hear the shape of it. So what I'll do, I'll turn my mic off a little bit and I'll adjust the 808 volume versus the kick volume. With the 808 louder than the kick, it feels like the 808 has no punch at all. Now let's make the kick louder than the 808. So it's just a matter of leveling. And there's other things we can get into, but that's the gist of your problem, is you have the sounds way too loud in the mixer. And that's why you have so much weirdness going on. Phoenix asks, what are three important skills beginners to know? That is, beginners of what? That's just such a broad thing. Maybe instead of that question, I'll show you three FL Studio shortcuts or things you need to know. How about that? So three things you need to know is the power of Fruity Delay 3. So let's make a melody in Hermes again. And let's go to Hermes, which should be ready this Friday. Let's start. Let's make a melody like G, D, B. Let's skip B. Let's go to F. What's wrong? Get all this stuff out of here. Do-do-do-do-do. Okay, so let me show you as I'm building this melody. I know I'm like thinking to myself. So I'm gonna drag these notes out and make this a chord, it's called. And I'll show you a couple shortcuts that I like in the piano roll. First shortcut is Alt. Let's do Alt A. So grab one note out of the chord, hit Alt A. And what it's gonna do is chop that note up. And then all you can do, what you have to do is change that time multiplier value. Now you can't hear it because the notes are blending in, so let me make it shorter. Hear that da 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 da. So it makes the melody a little more animated. You could also do it on like smaller notes, change that time multiplier. So it's your own glitch effect without any glitch plugins. It sounds almost like a video game with a da-da-da-da. Okay. Another thing you need to know in FL Studio is Fruity Delay 3, the power of Fruity Delay 3. It's not just the delay. So what you do, let's reset this back to default. What you do is turn your dry level down so you can get used to these effects. Turn your wet level all the way up, turn feedback level down, and turn delay time all the way down. Everything else becomes an effect. So you could turn up time modulation. And it creates like a Travis Scott wobble effect. I think I also have it. Here's what might be confusing the issue. I had vibrato on inside the plugin. So let me turn that off. So you'll hear the pitch. Let me turn it back off. Here's normal. Hear the pitch kind of moving around. And you could change the rate. I would keep it like in the middle. So that's the Travis Scott effect for free right in FL Studio. So we went over the shortcuts for how to chop up your melody in the piano roll. We went over Fruity Delay 3. And the other trick is soft clipper for your kicks. So let's add some drums up under here. Let me add my other effects like halftime. Pull this up and oh, there we go. The melody could be better. Let me take out this little stutter because it makes it sound like a video game. Okay. And add some drums. Where's our drums? Drums. Oh, we have it muted. No wonder. So on the kick, add Fruity Soft Clipper. Turn up your threshold. You don't have to pull pace post level down, but pull your fader down. And again, turn up your headphones to get better leveling. And you'll start to feel your beat move again. So that's how those are three tricks for you. Jonah says, can you add more slots to the mixer? Threshold not always enough for mixing vocals. Are you in FL Studio 20? Because I think right now, I thought it was infinite. So I'm not sure what version of FL you have. I don't know why you would need 120 tracks for anything. How's your computer even functioning with 120 tracks? Need to figure out a way to group those tracks together. That's what I would do. If you're not upgraded or whatever, I would just group those tracks. Put multiple things in one slot instead of using like a slot for every single sound. Because I don't know how you got to 100 and something mixer slots. Oh, vocals, you said. Yeah, especially you definitely need to group your vocals. You don't need to run every single one in a separate thing. Cool. How long have we been going here? Shout out to the 200 folks in here, but how long? I got to do math. Okay. We started at 145. It is 310. So if the guy on the train was traveling to Chicago at 25 miles an hour, like, oh, I got to do backwards math. I swear there was like a screen that showed you how long you've been on. Huh? Maybe I'm wrong. Thought I was looking at it the other day. I don't know. I don't know where it went. But I'll answer some more questions. We've been here since 1:45. That's about an hour and a half. Yeah, an hour and a half. Okay, so we've got a half an hour left to answer some more FL Studio stuff. So there, I'll leave a little dash, 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 and then just ask whatever you want to ask. Richana knows the plan. He's like, copy, paste, paste, paste. Paste right at the perfect time. Actually, you probably had it written and then you hit send. That's probably what you guys did. I'll let a couple more through since we have a good half hour. That's funny. I answered that networking question on for SAE. I was just on with SAE earlier. That's why my voice is kind of gone. I was on a live stream with them. So Rich Hunter says, the YouTube course on the premium isn't loading all the videos. Oh, thanks for letting me know. I got to fix that. Wondering why I wouldn't. That's weird. Okay. Would you use a transient shaper? Let me write this down. Are you talking about the new premium or the old premium? Well, I'll look it up. I'll look up both. I think it's probably the old one. We're transitioning to the new premium, so. But I thought all the old stuff was addressed. Anyway, isn't loading all the videos. Can you fix it? Would you use a transient shaper before or after compression? I would use it after compression because the whole point of a transient shaper is to create dynamic of volume, whereas a compressor, depending on how you use it, is usually used to tame the volume. So if I'm taming the volume or shaving off all the coolness, it's too smooth. Whereas a transient shaper is going to add that sharpness to it. So if I do sharpness before I smooth, I'm going to end up with smoothness. But if I do smoothness and then chisel out from the smoothness, I get my sharpness back. But it depends on how you use the compressor. What do you talk about in the FL Master's Guide course? Stuff like this. Just basically how to run through FL Studio like a master. Very quick shortcuts. You know what to look for. I've been doing this for a long time, so I've narrowed it down to these five buttons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are the only five buttons you really need to know about in FL Studio. Everything else is like them adding a bunch of stuff to it. So it's mainly how to navigate through FL Studio. It's how to use and make beats in FL Studio. And then that's mostly it. And then we have a couple bonuses as well. Because there's a lot of stuff I could teach you about FL that's just not relevant, like patcher. I mean, I rarely use patcher. It depends on like how advanced you are to even understand patcher. But I mean, there's a lot of cool stuff in FL, don't get me wrong. I just don't use it. Animus asks, how can we ask you specific questions about your course on your site? Email info at busyworksbeats.com. Or you can, well, yeah, I would do that because IG DMs, it separates everybody, and I don't check my DMs a lot. I don't use DMs for customer support unless I'm in a good mood and just want to go through DMs because it's harder for me to type with my thumbs than it is my keyboard. It just takes up so much energy and time to do it with your fingers. And DMs, yeah, but it depends on the question though. I mean, keep in mind it takes, I mean, I'll answer your question, I'll get to it eventually, but it's probably best you just asked it here though. Frenzy Daniel Hamdar, how do you take out that constant popping sound in halftime? How much you thinking Hermes gonna cost? Hermes, I'm still working on an offer, so it depends on what the offer would be. If you're just getting Hermes, it'll be about the same price as Vintage Fire. And then from there, we're going to have expansions. And then, you know, we're going to have bundle offers so you can get more than just Hermes. So it's going to be multiple things you can get. But if you just wanted Hermes, you can look at Vintage Fire. It started at $89.97. But I think for the early birds, I'm going to do like a $49.97 half off type of thing. Just for the people who get it first. And then you guys are going to help me with feedback, telling me what sounds you want in the next version of it. And we'll figure it out that way. I think $49.97 is fair for all the time and effort that went into this thing. It's, Hermes is basically the evolution of Vintage Fire. That's what it is. And I've been working on it for over 6 months. Dave the Driller, can you explain how to... Oh, I didn't answer your first question. How do you get the popping sound out of halftime? It's probably your sample. I don't think it's halftime doing that. Because this melody, let me listen to the pop. Depends on the sound. It depends on the sound because certain samples, if you don't, let me just explain this real quick. Popping noises comes from phase issues. So if you right click and go to edit and audio editor, if you zoom all the way in, a sound wave has positive values and it has negative values. Whenever a sound ends on a positive or negative value, it will create a click. But if it ends on a zero value, it won't create a click. Excuse me. So, trying to think how I can demonstrate this. So, let me chop this out. So let's say I just randomly chop this. My snap to grid is on zero crossings in Edison to prevent that clicky sound. But let's go to snap to samples and just randomly delete at a random point. And if you zoom all the way in with your mouse wheel, I love FL for putting this feature in here to just zoom in like this. Let me see. Are we all the way at the end? Okay, so see at the end, we're not fully at zero. I'm not sure if you can see that on your screen. But let me make this a little bit bigger. So that little dark line represents zero. This curvature line represents where the sound wave is right now. So it's not at perfect zero. So it's going to create it has a chance of creating a click or a pop. Because whenever you go from like high values to nothing again, or nothing to high value, it creates that click sound. So what people would do to prevent that is grab the tail end of the audio and they would create a fade out. That's why in Pro Tools, they fade a lot of their audio at the ends. How do I get it back to where it was? It was something, it looked like this. And then they create a fade out. So what the fade out does is it gradually lowers the volume down to zero. So now if we zoom all the way back in, the end value is absolute zero now. So if you look, the end value is that, it's called a node at zero. That's why you're getting the clicking. The clicking isn't from halftime. Some plugins create clicking because of the phase of the sound while it's processing the sound. So also timing could influence the clicking of something. Like, I have to take deeper breaths. I have a plugin that's called Pan Man. And if you pan hi-hats, it goes left, center, right, center. So if you pan it while the hi-hat's still playing on the left end, it will create a click because it's not done playing the sound. So you're probably getting just artifacts from phase. They're called phase artifacts. It's more than just the plugin, though. Oops. Dave's asked, can you explain how to use multi-band compression on 808s? I don't use it on 808s. I would use it on maybe an entire mix. So, but let's say you did want to use it on 808s. The only time I would use it is if I have a dramatic difference of frequency in the 808, because every 808 is different. So let's say you had a lot of high end and a lot of low end in your 808, and you wanted to tame the high end a little bit. So what I'm going to do again is turn my headphones up and turn stuff down. And let's say in this case, I wanted to tame the high end, even though it's not a lot of high end. Pull up any multi-band compressor you like. I'm trying to think. Isotope's probably the easiest one to show. Okay, so multi-band just means you want to tame one area of the song and not affect the rest. I mean the sound or song. So in this case, I only want to tame the high end of the 808. So I don't even need this third one. How to get rid of points in here? I don't know how to get rid of this point. Let me see if I control click. Does that do anything? What about alt click? Shift click? Nah, I don't know how to delete points once you add them. Maybe if I... Whatever, it doesn't really matter. What I'll do is just slide this down to where it's further down. So let's say you want to tame only the high end of the 808. Like the majority of the, if we solo it, it will sound like this. And the reason you would want to tame this is so you get the punch of the kick without interfering with the 808 doing its thing. So I would solo that band and lower the threshold. You got to be careful with compression because it can transform your sound to where it doesn't even sound like the sound anymore. So you got to be really careful with this. But what you're trying to do is tame the high end. I would give it a fair attack time, maybe 30 milliseconds. It depends on the 808 again. Pull your threshold down low enough to where the compressor is actually working. This one's at 2-to-1 ratio. I would probably put it up to like 4-to-1 for bass. So it's like a flatness to it. Let's unsolo this. So you lose some of that impact from the 808, but then you have to adjust with the kick. So I'll play it without the plugin on, and I'll play it with the plugin on, so you can hear the difference in the 808. It's super subtle, but you wouldn't even be using that much multi-band on an 808. You would use it on a track, an entire song. So at first I forgot we had the Thermionic Culture Vulture. So that was I didn't A-B it properly. So what I'll do now is play it without the multi-band compression and then with. So when this is on in gray mode, it's off. When it's green, it's on. And all we're doing with that is just getting rid of some of the high end. So, I mean, you wouldn't really use it on an 808 unless you wanted to combine a kick with an 808. Maybe the 808 was too buzzy and the kick was like fighting with its buzziness. This is a very nuanced case as to when you would do that. Chef asked, should I mix the whole beat using this method of having my headphones up and the channels low? Yes, but be careful because in FL, the channels are up by default, and any sounds you play in the browser are they're going to be the loudest. So you got to make sure when you're previewing sounds, turn your headphones down, or else you could like blow your eardrums off your face if you forgot to turn your headphones down. What's the sweet spot you would say for the master volume? Negative 12 dB. Somewhere between negative 12 and negative 6. It depends on if you're making a beat or a song too. But negative 6, let's say for a beat, negative 6, you got to leave enough headroom for like mixing and stuff. What is in the music business course? Which one? You're talking about, we have a couple. Let me see. Oh, let me mute my screen for a second. We have about 5 minutes and then we'll wrap it out. Shout out to the 200 folks in here. I'm assuming you're talking about the, hold on 1 sec. Make sure my screen ain't showing. Hold on. Give me a second. We're loading up the interface. So here's the new premium. Here's what it looks like on the back end. All right. So you can go through a bunch of different courses. So each one of these is a course. So you can open that up. That's the FL Studio course for beginners. And you can go through the entire course there. We also have YouTube course, vocal mixing, top notch. There's so many courses in here. It's crazy. I think it's over 26 combined. And they're full courses. So every picture you see here is a full course. So if you open that up, the entire YouTube course, stuff like that. So it's all mapped out for you. So I'm trying to figure out what you mean by business course. So it's also labeled via the topic. So this one's marketing. We have FL Studio, we have beat battle stuff, mixing, composition, and then all the courses are up top in the series line. Then we have recording, sound design in our recording one. So with marketing, which I'm trying to think what business course you could be referring to. Maybe social media dominance? Or are you talking about, you're talking about the, you're talking about the music. Okay, I know what you're talking about. Is my screen on? Yeah. You're talking about the other business course. So we transitioned this course. That's why I was like, what? I didn't know which business course you were talking about. But if you go to busyworksbeats.com/businessmastery, what it is it's all our mastermind meetings, but it's not only the mastermind meetings, it's me breaking down every single principle that we teach in the mastermind meetings. So for example, Trizza, who's right here in the middle, he was going over a lot about dealing with the two sides, online and offline. How do you balance money from the music industry, and how do you balance money from the actual industry, from the online music sales and different things. And I was showing how to build actual pillars within a business. It goes over principles about mindset. So it breaks, I wish I had it open. Let me see if I can find the file, because it would just be easier to just show you what's actually inside. So let me pull up. I know you can't see the screen, but give me a moment here to find the product. There's so much in here that I have to show you instead of talking about it. Music Business Mastery. Here we go. This doesn't have, all the stuff in this folder either. So never mind. Regardless of me showing you this stuff, what it is what I just said. It's basically going around the world, bringing the experts into these music producer mastermind meetings. You get all that raw footage, even footage we didn't post to YouTube. Plus, you get me breaking down every single thing that was brought up in the conversations within those mastermind meetings, from networking to leverage to, it's mindset stuff. It's a lot of business development stuff. It's more for the entrepreneur. It's not for everybody. So that's what's in that course. I'll have to move my files because I thought it was all in my Dropbox, but I have files all over the place for the mastery course. But here's what you'll learn. You will learn how to generate massive amounts of traffic to your business, the secrets behind top selling products and services, gain access to the back door of music opportunity, how to learn the secrets of the true 10x growth in sales, create an oiled machine of music business, which I've created myself, create time freedom for yourself and your family. So it's more like a starter kit for the entrepreneur trying to create a business within the music business. And that's course is not for everybody. It's for entrepreneurs who need that cutting edge type of information. But again, it's for entrepreneurs. I've started something on the side. It's called a mastermind group. So I've taught all those guys that type of stuff. So that's why I didn't really push that course as much, because I realized it's only for entrepreneurs. So I grouped all the entrepreneurs I know together, taught them my stuff. So I kind of transformed the course into a mastermind anyway, but that's that. How important is networking? Networking is, earlier with Frank from SAE, I was telling them how I define networking and we went through this whole thing. I'll keep it short. Let's break up the word net and work. Okay, so net is like a fish net. So when you use a fish net, you can capture a lot more fish for the same effort. Let me refresh the chat. Hold on, my chat's a little stuck. So with a fish net, you can throw it out with the same two hands and capture 3,000 fish. But if you use a rod, you cast a rod out with two hands and you can only catch one fish at a time. It makes more sense to throw a net. It takes the same two hands to get a much bigger result. So the goal of networking is to leverage. It's to use one thing to account for many things. That's what leverage is all about. Manu, what's up? I thought that was Manu from my first customer ever. But network means this. Net means total. Work is defined in physics as force times distance. What does that mean? So you are a force. You're a force by yourself. Now, when you're working, when I say work, but when you're being productive, let's use that term. When you're being productive over time or over a distance, that's called work. So work is you forcing something over a stretch of distance. That's you just doing your daily tasks. And that's you actually putting in the work. That's what work is. Now, when we're talking about net work, it's total work. So the goal is, how do you increase the W value? If W equals F times D, the only way to increase W is to increase F, okay? Or increase distance, how long you're going to do it. But we don't want to keep doing the same things over 50 years. We want to collapse 50 years into 5 years. But in order to get where we would have to go by ourselves in 50 years, we have to get the force multiplier there. So Jay Abraham talks about this a lot. He talks about force multiplier. When America, what's up? Is too busy right now? Oh yeah, that's hilarious. So in America, when we attack other countries, unfortunately, we send force multipliers. We send the Navy, the Marines, the Special Forces, we send the Air Force. We're attacking from all different angles, and that's called a force multiplier. And the chances of victory are a lot higher when you just keep going from different angles. Same thing here. So with work, in order to increase F, excuse me, in order to increase your work, you have to increase the value of F. So if F represents you and your singular force, you have to get people like you who can also add to that value. Bring in your friends, bring in your whoever friends, whatever. Get a bunch of your people that are about something that can contribute to a bigger vision together. And then that increases the work. So what is that? I know, hope he's going to say the same thing. But I just try to see yourself. I done it. That's what it does. Huh? I'm missing the context. Sorry, I missed the context there. But so that's what work. That's what network is. It's total you with a lot of other forces working towards a common goal. I can go deeper into what networking is, but you know, it could take forever to really explain the true nature of networking, because there has to be a trade involved in the network and there has to be a system of components. So I teach this in my, which one is it here? I think it's a social media dominance. Trying to look at the thumbnails. I think I teach it in our social media dominance course, how to think in, this is so high level that it's not going to make sense to people. When you organize, like, trying to think of an analogy. So your job, let's just use your job as an example of organization. So you have everybody who works a shift, right? If you work at Staples, you work a shift. Okay, so you have about 100 workers that are working that shift. Now, above the 100 employees, you have managers. They could be managers of the store, managers of the district, whatever. You have managers who manage stores that have a lot more employees than that one manager. So you can see, as we're going up the pyramid of authority, you're taking a lot of components or singular people, and you're turning them, you're adding them all together to add to the next level. So all those workers report to the next level of a manager. Then you have multiple managers per city. So you have multiple managers. You have about 1,000 managers around the U.S. Those 1,000 managers now report to the next level up. So as you go up these levels, you have to look at everything like micro components. I'm trying to think of an analogy with food. Like, for example, cake. Here's a good example. So cake starts with flour, eggs, butter, I think, is in the cake. Don't get me to making up ingredients. Sugar. And let's say, did I say eggs? I don't think milk's in eggs. So I don't know the ingredients to cake. But flour, eggs, sugar. What did I say? Flour, eggs, sugar, butter. Okay? The 4 ingredients to make cake. Now, if you ate eggs separate from the butter and separate from the flour and separate from the... I always miss that last ingredient, sugar. It would not taste like cake. So you have to look at cake as starting with eggs, flour, sugar, butter. Then you mix all those things together and you have batter. That's the next step. Then once you have the batter, you then bake it and you make the cake. So you can't, the problem is you can't undo the cake once it's baked. You can't turn a cake back into eggs and back into flour and back into sugar. So with networking, you have to understand that you are a piece of the ingredients. You are either the sugar, the flour, the butter, or the, what did I say? Or the sugar, the flour, butter, or the eggs. You're one of those things. Now, the end goal for your network is to create the cake, but you can't create the cake as just an egg. You can't create the cake as just sugar, just flour, or just butter. You have to combine your specialty with somebody else's specialty. And then you all form together and you go to that next level with a common vision. So that's what it's all about. That's how you think about networking. How do you link up with people who are components that can contribute to a bigger vision? So it looks like you guys are helping each other out. Appreciate that. So I'm going to wrap this because we've been going till about, we started at 1:30. Yeah. So we've been going for about 2 hours. My voice is gone because I was in another call before this. So I'm going to wrap this out and eat and just get to what I have to get to. Again, the sales page for Hermes will be up before Friday. Friday is the intended launch. And with Hermes, it should, for early birds, I think I'm going to start it at $49.97, to be fair. The price is going to be normally $89.97. And we're going to have different bundles and different things. Just like Call of Duty, when Call of Duty comes out, you can buy the regular Call of Duty, or you could buy the gamer's version of Call of Duty, or you could buy the whole Call of Duty ghillie suit along with the bundle. So it's going to be different things you can get with Hermes. It's not going to be just Hermes. Instrumentals off the grid to make it groove. Good question. Yeah, here's a new technique I meant to show you guys. I'm glad you reminded me, actually, because I forgot to show you. A cool new technique with hi-hats that I like to use for boom bap, or really, yeah, boom bap stuff, is, let me find a hi-hat that sounds like this one. Okay. So go to your new track, and then go to, this is an FL Studio 20, by the way. Go to your graph editor, and then click on shift mode. Okay, so let me right-click, fill each 2 steps like a normal hi-hat. Let's go to a boom bappy BPM, like 84, 88. Let's go to 88. Okay, so now I'm under the shift tab, and then you want to just shift every note just at different things. So treat it almost like velocity. But the key is that every note has a shift value. No note's not going to have a shift value. So I want you to listen to the swing on the hi-hats. I'm going to turn it up. Let me turn my headphones down. And you can create really unique custom grooves using that. So you can use that for your kicks. You can use it for your hi-hats. All right, so we're going to wrap this up. Thank you, everyone, for joining this FL Studio Masterclass. Maybe we'll do another Q&A thing about FL Studio soon. And I don't have anything to sell you or tell you to go. I just want you to smash that like button and subscribe if you're new. Hermes will be out. What's today? Today's Thursday. Hermes will be out Friday. So I'm going to have the sales page up by Friday. Again, the starting price, since people keep asking, the base model is going to be $49.97, which is half off of $89.97 because you guys are going to be the first ones to get it. So you guys have that advantage. And, you know, when it goes back up to regular price, it's $89.97. But again, there's going to be different versions of Hermes. You can have the... Now, Hermes as is, you're going to get the same exact Hermes plugin as if you were to get it in the bundle. There's no, like, FL Studio Producer Edition, FL Studio, you know, Signature Edition. It's not going to be like that to where you don't get tools. But maybe I'll add in, like, cool bonuses like other drum kits or courses or something. If you want to grab all that stuff at like a discount, we'll bundle it together and sell it at a different price. So that's the offer. It'll start at $49.97. That's half off of its normal price. But that's only for people who grab it within the first, let's say, week, to be fair, to give you guys the advantage. Maybe a week or two, maybe 2 weeks. All right, so that was it. And that's all I have to say. What else do I have to tell you guys? I'm just excited. All my projects are done, so we finally get to have fun again. For 6 months, I was making behind the scenes with my team. Shout out to Aaron behind the scenes. Shout out to Martin behind the scenes. Shout out to Josh behind the scenes. They helped me with Hermes. It took about 6 months to do it. So it's a long, you know, it was, that's a long time to be excited. So my excitement kind of wore off after a while. And then I was like, you know, I want to be excited again. Now I'm excited again. So it just, anyway. All right, I'm going to wrap it up. Thank you all. It's Busy Works Beats. Oh, here's the time right here in the thing. It's right there. 1 hour and 56 minutes. Okay. Anyway, thank you for watching today. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.